to what I'm going to bill as a double header this week, since because of the juxtaposition of dates, we have not only a very important lecturer and topic to think about today, but I want to invite you to mark on your calendars, as is the tradition in this series, the next event. And the next event is Friday. Because of the schedules of Jackie Simmons and Jim Ridenour, on October 23rd, same room, same time, easy to remember, James Ridenour will be with us to examine the natural environment from his perspective as director of the National Park Service. He will speak on the topic, rather interesting one these days, turning rhetoric into reality, actions to protect our national parks in the 21st century. So I hope to see you again on Friday, same place, same time, to hear Jim Ridenour share his views with us. This morning, it's my very great pleasure to present to you Jacqueline A. Simmons, who prefers to go by Jackie, a specialist in environmental litigation and a visiting professor at the Indiana University School of Law. A 1976 honors graduate in government from the University of Notre Dame, Ms. Simmons earned her own JD degree, again with honors, from Indiana University School of Law in 1979. In that year, she began her association with the Indianapolis law firm of Ice Miller, Donatio, and Ryan, where she is now an environmental partner. In this capacity, she pursues class action and enforcement litigation addressing compliance issues under federal laws dealing with air, water, solid, and hazardous waste, and occupational safety and health. She counsels clients on environmental issues related to business transactions, drafts warranties and indemnity agreements, and negotiates remediation plans and compliance schedules. Bringing this expertise to the classroom of the IU Law School, she teaches courses in environmental litigation and environmental issues in business transactions. Ms. Simmons has also served as chairperson of the environmental section of the Indiana State Bar Association and presently is the editor of its newsletter. She's a frequent writer and speaker for such organizations as the Indiana Association of Cities and Towns, the Indiana CPA Society, the Legal Education Institute, the Indiana Water Pollution Control Association, and the National Business Institute. In planning this series, along with many colleagues, those on the Green Committee and those in their departments, we certainly needed a speaker who could examine environmental concerns from the legal perspective. And I want to give full credit here to a graduate of our Honors College, who many of you know, Jan Abbs, who was an associate of Jackie Simmons at Ice Miller, and she suggested Jackie, and that's how the contact was made, and here she is. I want you to join me now, if you would, in welcoming to Provost Lecture Series Jackie Simmons, who will present a lecture entitled Municipalities, the Environment, and the Law. Ms. Simmons.
Thank you. When I first began practicing environmental law, I represented mostly industries, and then a number of the cities in Indiana began to be sued by the United States Environmental Protection Agency, primarily because our sewer systems in Indiana have been the last thing to get money and to get built, to get updated, to get expanded, as the growth in our cities has occurred over the last few decades. So I began to represent a large number of cities as well. I found during that representation of cities that the interests of industry and the cities were quite closely aligned, which had surprised me because I had heard that cities and industries, when it came to environmental issues, were at opposite ends of the pole. The reason for that was because oftentimes the frontline enforcer of environmental laws and regulations is the county health department or the city's publicly owned treatment works, the city's sewer system, the city's air board, whatever. And so oftentimes industries within a city saw that the person knocking on their door to do an inspection or to bring them an enforcement action or whatever was a city official. When it came to sewage treatment plants and the need to upgrade them and update them to make them larger to accommodate this growth in Indiana, I saw that industry and cities could work together. It was in the industry's best interest if the city would update its sewage treatment plant. So if the industry wanted to add more jobs to your community, add a new plant or whatever, it would be able to do so. But if the city's sewage treatment plant was horribly outdated and couldn't handle what was currently being put down our pipes and drains and toilets to the city, then the industry wouldn't be allowed to expand. So coming at the idea of cities and industry working together, trying to solve environmental problems, trying to create new solutions, more creative solutions, I had a much more optimistic view of the possibility for a real-life partnership between our municipalities, counties, and industries within those jurisdictions. Then I became involved in the Superfund arena, and people told me once again that I would find that cities and industries were busy fighting each other, litigating with each other, and arguing over who had to pay for the cleanup of our hazardous waste sites. How many of you have heard of the Superfund statute, either through the newspapers or on TV or whatever? How many of you have heard of Superfund? Okay, good. The Superfund statute is designed to clean up our old waste dumps, old disposal sites. In order to do that, the statute has specifically done away with many of the defenses that lawyers would traditionally use. For instance, it is not a defense under the Superfund statute if you dispose of waste at a landfill and that landfill happens to be one of the sites selected for the Superfund cleanup. It is not a defense that your government told you to take your trash to that landfill. It is not a defense that you had a permit to take your trash to that landfill. In some recent cases, it is not even a defense that EPA, in cleaning up one landfill, told you to take your waste to another landfill, only to find out that 5 years later that second landfill is also a Superfund site. So we traded away some of our traditional notions of defenses and equity and fairness. So I always warn people right up front that when you talk about our Superfund statute, you have to wipe all notions of fairness out of your brain. Now that was an absolute trade-off that people were aware that they were doing when they passed this law. The reason for that is because it was believed that the overwhelming social good in cleaning up these past disposal sites and past landfills outweighed the problems with retroactive liability, with the fact that you would now be held liable under statutes passed in 1980 for the way you disposed of your trash in 1940 and 1950 and 1960. So the Congress created retroactive liability. And in 1982, thinking I was a pretty hotshot lawyer, I wrote just a magnificent brief for the United States Supreme Court in which I showed to them how it was clearly unconstitutional, that you absolutely could not have retroactive liability because Congress can pass no ex post facto law. Well, the Supreme Court proved me wrong on that one. I'm sure they'll prove me wrong on others down the road. In addition, the Superfund statute provides for what is known as joint and several liability. Now, that's a term that a lot of lay people have a hard time understanding until you give them a real-life example. I represented Butler University recently at a Superfund site in Illinois, and Butler had sent one drum of waste to a site. In fact, the drum, when it reached the site that is now the Superfund site, no longer had the waste in it. The waste had been incinerated. This site in Illinois is a drum recycler. All sounds good. Sounds like what we ought to be doing. And the contents of the drum had been incinerated. All that was left when it reached the site in Illinois was whatever residue remained. The drum recycler was supposed to properly clean that drum and then could resell it. Unfortunately, the drum recycler got kind of behind on things, and a few million drums backed up. And not all of them were emptied quite as much as you would like for them to be, and many of them had rusted through, and the contents of those drums had leaked all over the ground. An Illinois EPA ordered a cleanup. The cleanup, at the time that I first got involved, was estimated to be about a $12 million cleanup to get rid of all those drums, to clean up the contaminated soil, and to deal with some runoff into a nearby creek. Butler University, under legal theories, is potentially liable for the entire $12 million of cleanup. That's what joint and several liability is. If you have any waste at a Superfund site, you are, in theory, liable for the entire cleanup of that site. Now, you may have some rights to go after other folks who also contributed to the problem or also contributed waste or also sent drums to the site, but in theory, anyway, you are liable for the entire amount of the cleanup. That is a very powerful sword which EPA can use with regards to these responsible parties or potentially responsible parties to get them to settle with EPA, to get them to agree to pay some dollar amount to help towards the cleanup. Now, that one barrel at that one site in Illinois with $12 million of potential liability, there were literally 4 or 5 million barrels at the site. So you would say, well, you know, then each barrel only has to cost you $3 or $4 or $5, so what's the big deal? I advise Butler to go ahead and pay the $8,000 for that one barrel to get a de minimis settlement and be done with it. And so for those folks who had sent little, relatively small amounts to that Superfund site, the unfairness of joint and several liability is that they end up paying a very large proportionate share of the cleanup. Reason for that is that a number of those drums would never be tracked down to any particular owner. A number of drums would be tracked down to an owner which was now a bankrupt company, and you could no longer get the money from it. But on to the topic of cities. How do cities, then, municipalities, get drawn into this whole Superfund weave? Well, let's take a look at the four ways in which you can be a potentially responsible party under the Superfund statute. There are four classes of potentially responsible parties. And for those of you in the back, I'll read this to you so you don't have to worry about trying to strain yourself to see this. Those people who are potentially responsible at Superfund sites are the current owner or operator of the facility. And for purposes of my talk today, instead of a facility, instead of a plant or a manufacturing plant, I'm going to talk about your typical sanitary landfill, your typical municipal trash dump. So the owner or operator of the facility is a potentially responsible party. Prior owners and operators of the facility, if somebody else owned that landfill until 1980 and waste was disposed of at that landfill during the period of time that they owned it, that prior owner or operator also has joint and several liability. The third category is any person who arranged for disposal or treatment of hazardous substances at the landfill. Any person who arranged for disposal. So a typical industry who arranges with somebody to pick up their trash and take it to the landfill. Similarly, the cities for whom they don't have enough, some cities in Indiana don't even have enough trucks, don't even have enough manpower to go around and collect trash themselves, city trash. They hire private haulers, and they make contracts and arrangements with the private haulers to go around the city and pick up trash. In those instances, the city is someone who arranged for the disposal of its citizens' trash. And finally, the fourth category is any person who transports for disposal hazardous substances. Again, that picks up some cities if they're large enough to have their own city trash trucks who pick up the trash. So that means that municipalities are often potentially responsible parties at Superfund sites. And there are really two ways that most municipalities get caught into that web of Superfund liability. The first way is when they are an owner or operator of the landfill. And some cities have been owners and operators of their own landfill for lots of reasons, including the fact that it's just a hassle and it's hard to get the right person to run the landfill. Most cities in Indiana chose not to become the owner of the landfill. Instead, they usually contracted with a private individual who was the owner or operator. But it is possible for a city to be an owner or operator of a landfill. And the second one is by way of arranging for disposal of municipal solid waste. For purposes of giving you an example of how unfair this statute can be and how it can really work a hardship on municipalities and on you and I as taxpayers in cities in Indiana, we're going to ignore the first type of liability. Because when you are the owner or operator of the landfill, if you're a city or if you're an industry, it really doesn't matter. There aren't very many differences between you other than how that will get funded in terms of paying for the liability. But with regard to the second category of potential liabilities for cities, there's a really troubling aspect here. The problem is that when the city arranges to pick up my trash and your trash and your parents' trash, the vast majority of that trash is not a hazardous substance. Sure, we all throw away some pesticide cans now and then, which, by the way, you should not be doing. We have all thrown away some empty cans of oil when we change the oil in our car. We have all thrown away some half-empty cans of paint or some paint thinner or something as we're cleaning out our garage or our house. But the vast majority of what we send out there, especially until recent years when we were no longer allowed to send our tree limbs and grass clippings and our newspapers, at least in Indianapolis, we're not allowed to do that anymore. But until recently, that's what the vast majority by volume of municipal or city trash was. You know, your packaging from all your different food products that you've bought, some spoiled food out of your refrigerator, leftovers, newspapers, yard waste, that kinds of things. Those things that are not hazardous substances. EPA has conducted some studies. Now, here's a fun summer job for most college students. How would you like to stand at the gates of a landfill for the summer, stop random selected trucks bringing in city trash, have them dump the trash onto the ground, and then you go through and try to separate out the hazardous stuff from the non-hazardous stuff, and then weigh it? Well, believe it or not, EPA has had some grant programs in the last few years where they've done just that. They've hired college students, mainly because I think you're cheap labor, comparatively speaking, to do exactly that kind of job. And they have found out that between a low of a half of a percent to a high of 4% by weight of the trash that comes into a typical sanitary or municipal landfill and is truly city trash, not an industry's trash, but city trash, is a hazardous substance. So only one half of 1% to a high of 4% is what is hazardous within the volume that every city takes to a landfill. And these numbers, by the way, are not municipality numbers, they're not industry numbers. These are studies done by EPA, and they are numbers cited in an EPA policy document that I'll talk to you about in just a minute. So it is troubling from the standpoint that the typical industry that sends waste to that landfill will have anywhere from 50% to as much as 85% of their trash and waste be what would qualify as a hazardous substance under the Superfund statute. The reason industrial waste differs dramatically is that for the most part, up until very recent years, industries that could burned off anything that was non-hazardous. They had huge trash fires where they burned their wooden pallets and they burned all of the cardboard, and they got rid of those kinds of things rather than to pay the landfill to take them. So industrial trash, until recent tightening up of our air pollution laws, often contained a very high percentage of hazardous substances. I'd like to tell you exactly what is a hazardous substance, but believe me, that would take the rest of my time here today. So I just want to mention to you briefly that the definition of a hazardous substance under the Superfund statute is very, very broad. The statute specifically says anything which has been listed as hazardous by any one of four other environmental statutes, water statute, our air statute, our toxic substances control statute, or our hazardous solid and hazardous waste laws, the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, are hazardous substances. Many times when you hear lectures, you will hear as an example that whiteout used by your typical office would qualify as a hazardous substance under the Superfund statute because of some of the solvents used in the whiteout. Carbon paper would qualify as a hazardous substance. There are a number of things that we just typically use that would be hazardous substances that you and I don't think of as being truly harmful or hazardous. So that's a very large category of potential hazardous substances. So now we have the city who has taken city trash for 30 or 40 years to the landfill. Everything was fine as long as the landfill operated properly. And then in 1980 or 1985, EPA came in and said, whoa, groundwater studies in this area show that this landfill has contaminated the neighbor's wells. We've got to do something. We can't let these people continue to drink contaminated water. And so we're going to require a study and a cleanup of that landfill. So now the city is in a real dilemma. They, like industry, face unfair, retroactive, joint and several liability of Superfund. So the city could be liable for the entire amount of the landfill cleanup. It is also clear that in passing the Superfund statute, Congress intended that taxpayers would not pay the burden, that we would not be the ones who would pay for these cleanups of the now over 2,000 sites on our national priorities list or our Superfund list of sites to be cleaned up. But on the other side of that dilemma are the realities of municipal finance, the realities of being a mayor or a city councilman in a relatively small town in Indiana with maybe an overall per year budget of $10 million per year, facing a potential Superfund liability of $20 or $30 or $40 million for a landfill that you have sent trash to for the last 30 or 40 years. In fact, in Indiana, some of our problems with municipal finance are compounded a little bit because of some peculiarities in Indiana law. Our municipal budgets are set long in advance in Indiana. By August of 1992, the cities had to have already held hearings and had to have already submitted to the State Board of Tax Commissioners their budgets for 1993. 1993 budgets are then approved by the State Board of Tax Commissioners. If they are approved, then the cities actually start to see some of that tax revenue money no earlier than May of 1993, when that money is actually collected, and then in November. Because we actually pay property taxes in Indiana, which is the largest basis for cities to have financing, the property taxes are paid 1 year in arrears in Indiana. So you're really talking of May of 1994 before a tax increase that the city council approved in June or as late as August of 1992 actually starts to come into the city's coffers. So we have some real problems with municipalities. Another problem we have, and this is a problem in every state except Vermont, is that there are constitutional or statutory debt limits in all 49 states except Vermont. 42 states have actual constitutional debt limits, meaning it, by constitution, as in Indiana, the local government entity cannot exceed a debt limit. In Indiana, it happens to be 2% of the assessed value of the entire city. 7 additional states require a balanced budget by statute or law. That is a little bit easier to get around than a constitutional debt prohibition because you could convince your state legislature, hopefully, that you would need some change in the law. But it is still a real-life problem for most cities. EPA has been aware of this dilemma. EPA has been aware of the fact that it's not a very politically smart thing to do to enforce against mayors of major cities and have those mayors go running to their congressmen who sit on the oversight committees for many of the committees that oversee EPA. So EPA has attempted to respond to the unfairness of this dilemma. How have they done that? The first way that they did that was through their municipal settlement policy, which was issued December 12, 1989. The municipal settlement policy, and I have the citation for it if any of you are real interested, is 54 Federal Register 51071. 54 Federal Register 51071. In that policy, EPA declared that the statute, the Superfund statute, does not provide an exemption from liability for cities except in two very small instances. If you give land to the city, for instance, or if the city obtains ownership of land involuntarily, because in many urban areas people were deeding over contaminated property to their cities, then the city is not liable as an owner under Superfund. And the second exception is when the city does something to try to do a cleanup. If the city takes some emergency response, if their firemen go out to put out a fire, and in putting out the fire, the water spreads chemicals all over the ground, the city is not liable for that kind of Superfund liability. But other than those two exceptions, EPA has declared that, yes, in fact, municipalities and counties, just like industry, are jointly and severally retroactively liable under the Superfund statute. You say, gee, what a great break, what a wonderful response to the unfairness. The reason EPA did this was that it felt that if it carved out municipalities totally, that there would be such an uprising by industry that industry would not be willing to continue to settle these cases to pay for the cleanups themselves. So EPA did exactly what I would have expected and exactly the way the statute reads and found that municipalities are in fact liable. So EPA said it would seek information from municipalities. It would send out letters or questions requesting information. They said they would name cities as potentially responsible parties at Superfund sites, and they have done that. However, they went on to say that neither a municipality nor an industry will be named as a potentially responsible party when they only generated or transported municipal solid waste, unless there was site-specific information that that particular municipal waste contained hazardous substances. So neither an industry nor a city would be named as a potentially responsible party in a Superfund lawsuit by EPA unless EPA had site-specific information that the municipal solid waste sent by that city or that industry in fact did contain hazardous substances. EPA said they would not rely on studies of similar kinds of trash. They would not allow anybody to come in and say, well, I think in 1979 I threw away a can of hairspray. They wanted site-specific information. What that meant was that cities were not being named as defendants in Superfund suits, nor were universities, for instance. Universities have a large amount of municipal solid waste that goes to landfills. And they were not being named because very seldom did EPA have a real witness or real evidence that actually, in fact, with that particular landfill, that the solid waste brought by the city or brought by the university contained a hazardous substance. So in fact, what EPA announced in the settlement policy was that it was going to use its enforcement discretion. Given limited resources within the agency, limited numbers of people, limited amounts of money to go after people who should be cleaning up Superfund sites, they said, we're not going to go after municipalities or industry that only sent municipal solid waste. Now, they continued to say, we're not going to go after municipalities or industry that only sent municipal solid waste, when in fact there are very, very few instances in which an industry can show that it sent only municipal solid waste and nothing from its manufacturing facility or whatever. It also announced in the settlement policy that it would have separate settlements with municipalities or industries that were in that position, that had sent only municipal solid waste. So while EPA was suing a large number of industrial people, it would settle separately with the city. And then it would be between the city and EPA as to how much the city would pay. So they announced that they would enter into these separate settlement agreements. That's very important because if EPA settles with the municipality or with the university or with whoever it is that sent only municipal solid waste, the other potentially responsible parties at that Superfund site no longer have a cause of action. They can't sue the city. They can't try to get some contribution or some assessment against the city. Once EPA settles with the city is off the hook. The next thing that happened that was extremely significant was a case decided by the Second Circuit in April of 1992. It's cited at the bottom of this slide. It's called B.F. Goodrich versus Murtha. And B.F. Goodrich, quite honestly, has gotten a lot of bad press about this case because they say B.F. Goodrich had the nerve to sue 20 cities in Connecticut because of a landfill cleanup problem out there. In fact, what happened was that B.F. Goodrich and five other companies had been ordered by U.S. EPA to conduct a landfill cleanup at two landfills in Connecticut. The total dollar amount for those cleanups was $47 million. $47 million. Even for big companies like B.F. Goodrich, their share of a $47 million cleanup is a huge sum. So B.F. Goodrich and the five other industries decided to sue the landfill owner-operator, which was a man by the name of Murtha. And that's why the case is titled B.F. Goodrich versus Murtha. Mr. Murtha, the owner-operator of the landfill, in turn brought in 200 additional defendants, other industries, and the 20 Connecticut cities and towns. When he brought in the cities and towns, they all got together and said, now wait a minute, we can get out of this lawsuit. All we sent was municipal solid waste. We just pick up our citizens' trash, we took it to the landfill, we didn't send any hazardous substances to this landfill other than minor amounts that might have been in our citizens' trash. So they sought a ruling from the court known as a summary judgment. They wanted the court to say that as a matter of law, cities are not liable under the Superfund statute, where all they do is pick up or arrange for the disposal of their citizens' trash. And they had three basic arguments. The first one was that they claimed that Congress, in passing the Superfund statute, intended to focus on industries. And there's a lot of discussion in the record, in the congressional record, that congressmen were trying to target specific industries. Those who had caused the problem should pay for the problem. Lots of great rhetoric like that. Unfortunately for the cities, the statute doesn't read quite that way. And the statute specifically appears to accommodate municipalities on those two exceptions I mentioned before, and therefore implies that they're otherwise liable, except for the two exceptions where they're not liable, when they do an emergency response or where they involuntarily become the owner of land. The statute implies that they are in fact liable and that Congress thought of that. So the court didn't buy that argument. Furthermore, the court even goes on to some social policy issues and says, even if we bought your argument that Congress intended for industry rather than taxpayers to pay for landfill cleanups, the problem with your argument is that if we don't require local cities and municipalities to pay for these cleanups, what will happen is that eventually federal taxpayers all across the country will have to pay for these cleanups. And it's clear that Congress did not intend for federal taxpayers to pay for these cleanups. So the court seems to buy the argument that it's better off for a few of us who happen to be unlucky enough to live near a landfill that becomes a Superfund site to pay for that cleanup than it is for all taxpayers across the country to bear the burden evenly. The second argument that the cities had is that under the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, or our hazardous waste law, there is a specific exemption from the definition of hazardous waste for household trash or household waste. And they said, since Congress specifically exempts from the hazardous waste laws all household trash, they likewise intended to exclude from the definition of hazardous substances all household waste. Problem with that argument is that the Superfund definition of hazardous substances is this broad, and the hazardous waste definition under RCRA is this broad. When the Congress defined hazardous substances, it refers to a large number of environmental laws and says anything listed as hazardous under all of these statutes is a hazardous substance for purposes of Superfund. So think of hazardous waste as just a little subset of the huge, large set of hazardous substances. So the court very quickly did away with that argument as well. Finally, the cities argued that under this municipal settlement policy that I just told you about, EPA had announced its intention not to go after cities, and therefore that EPA had recognized that municipalities were not liable under Superfund. Boy, did they miss the mark on that one, because if you read the municipal settlement policy, which is only a couple of pages long, there are at least three times in that municipal settlement policy where EPA says municipalities and are liable. It's only when you get to the part on their enforcement discretion and whether or not they're going to go after those municipalities in the first instance, or whether they're going to give them a break by settling them with them separately, that EPA begins to make a distinction and say, yes, we'll use our enforcement discretion and we will settle with them separately. But nowhere in that document does EPA say that municipalities are not liable. That decision in April of 1992 led to incredible political pressure. And I will tell you that if it weren't an election year, I think we would have had new legislation this year. You have never seen so many mayors, so many congressmen up in arms in your life. I have a couple of mayors who literally flew out to Washington, D.C. to testify in committee hearings about how this would bankrupt their cities if the local landfill were to become a Superfund cleanup site, and a couple of my cities are already involved in Superfund cleanup sites, and how that could bankrupt the cities if they are found liable for the entire amount of the cleanup. In fact, there is a town in Colorado that has declared bankruptcy. The entire town had to declare bankruptcy because the amount of the Superfund judgment against the town exceeds the total assessed value of everything in the town. And believe me, the mayors can all cite for you the exact town, the name of the mayor. They all know it because they've heard this story at their various mayors' conferences. In Indiana, towns are not allowed to declare bankruptcy, so it'd be interesting to see what happened if we had a judgment against a city in Indiana that exceeded the total assessed value of the entire city. Because by law in Indiana, even a judgment against a city is subject to that constitutional debt limit. So we'd have some real interesting problems there. So the MRFA decision led to incredible political pressure, and EPA responded. It had actually been working on this issue since 1989, but in May of 1992, I guess trying to appear as if they acted so quickly that between April and May they came out with a proposal. In fact, they'd been working on this for 3 years. EPA came out with a proposal. The key elements of this proposal were that EPA would negotiate settlements with municipalities. They would, in fact, continue to negotiate with them, and they would give them contribution protection. They would make sure that the other industries involved at the site could not sue the city. EPA also did something rather remarkable. It said it would determine the percentage of the landfill costs to be borne by each municipality. EPA would do that. Rather than having courts decide it, rather than having arbitrators decide it, EPA would do that. And EPA decided to propose a specific number. Now, originally, they had considered proposing that cities pay 30 to 50% of the cleanup costs of a landfill. The last government accounting office report on a typical Superfund cleanup was $20 million for a landfill. Cities were outraged when they heard that they could be held liable for as much as 30 to 50%. So then EPA took that number back and said, well, how about 15%? The cities still rallied together and put incredible political pressure on EPA. So EPA finally decided on a formula that largely ignores waste volume and says that municipalities would pay 4% of the cleanup costs for any landfill. So if the municipality sent 90% of the volume, if it sent 10% of the volume, if it sent 50% of the volume, they would pay 4% of the cleanup costs. So on your average $20 million cleanup for a landfill, the city would pay about $800,000. That proposal met with extreme opposition as well, but guess what? This time not by the cities. The cities were willing to live with a 4% proposal. Instead, the Chemical Manufacturers Association, the American Petroleum Institute, and other industry organizations just screamed. And they went immediately to President Bush's counsel and got him to agree to keep this proposal from becoming a final regulation. So that regulation or proposal has been held up by the White House since May of 1992. I'll go out on a real limb here and tell you it's not coming out before the election. There's no way. Even if the election were about 5 months away instead of 2 weeks away, I guarantee you it would not come out. In the meantime, what has happened is that EPA has exercised its enforcement discretion. It has not been bringing suits against cities, except in very unusual instances or where the city was truly the owner and operator of the landfill. They have, however, been agreeing to enter into separate settlements with the cities. If a city comes forward and says, look, we know that we're going to eventually get hit with some liability here, we'd rather pay for it over a longer period of time, EPA will enter into those kinds of settlement agreements, and they will allow the city to pay in over time. They do make the city pay a little bit more. They do a time value of money kind of analysis and make the city pay a little bit more, but they will extend those payments, so to speak. Because EPA held this up and because so many municipalities have lobbied so hard, Senator Lautenberg is still pushing for his legislative proposal, his legislative fix. What Senator Frank Lautenberg, who's a Democrat from New Jersey, has proposed, and he got the full Senate to adopt this, by the way, in July of this year, July of 1992, has not passed the House yet, was an amendment to the Superfund statute that would incorporate the EPA's proposal. In other words, it would cap a municipality's liability. The way the Lautenberg bill does this, though, is really pretty interesting. It actually bars all claims, all lawsuits under Superfund based on the generation, handling, or disposal of municipal solid waste, except those lawsuits that are brought by EPA. So only EPA can sue a city. The industries, the BF Goodriches of the world would be out of luck. Mr. Murtha couldn't have brought in his 20 Connecticut cities. The Lautenberg proposal, as I've already told you, I don't think is going to pass. Senator Lautenberg, actually with some foresight, had a similar proposal in the 1991 Congress that also did not pass. So here's my solution. And I'll do my first wish list solution, which you may find a little unusual for an environmental lawyer, because someone has suggested that CERCLA, which is the proper name or the acronym for the proper name for the Superfund statute, is the Consulting Engineers Retirement and Complete Enjoyment of Life Act. And others have suggested that it is the environmental attorneys, same sort of thing, that it is the way that we're funding our retirements and our complete enjoyment of life. So it is true that at every Superfund site that I'm at, the other day I was at a Superfund steering committee meeting. This is one of probably 50 I will have on the Superfund site. I looked around the table, there were 32 lawyers. Many of them were from Washington, D.C. and New York, so I averaged their hourly rate at $300 an hour. Some were from Chicago, so I put $250 an hour, and the rest of us from Indianapolis, I put anywhere from $150 to $200 an hour. I came up with $48,000 per hour was being spent on this crazy meeting at the Superfund site, and we're going to have 50 such meetings. There will be hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not in the low $1 million range, of just attorney's fees, in getting this landfill cleanup organized and in coming up with all the various documents and all the various proposals as to the dollar amount to be contributed by each of the PRPs at that landfill site. That is an incredible waste of our resources. Even though I don't mind it on a weekly basis, in an overall social policy perspective, it's an incredible waste of our resources. So my unrealistic proposal, but the most equitable, would be if taxpayers are to pay the costs of cleanups, then all taxpayers should pay them. We should get away from the idea that only polluters pay under Superfund, because that's not the way it's working anyway. Some of the worst polluters in the world are now bankrupt, and they're not paying. Some of the people who have contributed very innocuous substances are paying the largest amounts. And incredible legal fees and incredible consulting engineer time is being spent on trying to point the finger at who sent the worst stuff to a landfill and how much should they pay. I think that the overall cost to society would be greatly reduced if we just placed a tax on every product in the United States, every product, and then went ahead and used that money and created a true super fund that paid for these cleanups rather than having lawyers and engineers fight it out. Now, I will also tell you that I know there is no chance that that proposal would pass. It is so deeply ingrained in some people that polluters pay that they can't see the inequities or how the system has failed to work in real life. A more realistic and more equitable proposal, I think, is a slight change or a slight spin-off of the EPA proposal and the Lautenberg proposal. The one thing that I will agree on behalf of industry is unfair about setting the municipal contribution at a 4% level is that the most common remedy at a landfill is to put a cap on the top of the landfill, to put clay, to put plastic liners, more clay, some topsoil, some grass. If you're talking about capping a landfill, then volume does make a difference. If a city sent 90% by volume to a landfill and only has to pay 4% because only 4% of their waste was hazardous substances, then somebody else is going to pick up the cap, the price of the cap, that goes up tremendously due to the area, due to the volume of waste, due to the area that now has to be capped. And that seems to me to be a little skewed. So what I would do is I would take a municipality share based on a volume in basis and multiply it by 4%. So if an industry sent 1 million cubic yards to a landfill, I would make them pay for 4% of that million. The advantages of my proposal over EPA's proposal, or over the Lautenberg proposal, is that it does take into account volume. And that is important, especially at landfill sites. It is not quite as offensive to industry, where volume is the deciding factor for most sites as to how much each industry will pay. And it also allows industry to feel like at least something about volume is being considered with regard to the municipality's share. On the other hand, it has major advantages for the municipalities as well. They won't have to hire environmental lawyers in addition to their city attorneys to go sit in these stupid steering committee meetings for the rest of their life. And they won't have to hire lawyers to fight in court about whether or not municipalities should be found liable or not when all they did was pick up our city trash. It gives them some certainty. It allows them to budget for the future. It allows them to know what their cost will be. The one problem with my proposal that I'll readily admit is that at many sites, there are no volumetric records. Many landfills in the 50s, 60s, 70s didn't keep records, and all we have are rough estimates as to some guy who worked at the landfill every day, 5 days a week, for 50 years or 50 weeks out of every year for 40 years, and he may be able to give you some rough percentages of what the city's trash versus the largest industry versus the next largest industry will be. And I admit that that is a problem and a failing. On the other hand, that is a problem and a failing at every Superfund site, and we deal with it all the time by working with the best information that we have available to us. I'd like to take any questions that you have or respond to anything that you may have thought of during this presentation.
Thank you very much.
Yes?
With this bunch, I'm sure you'll have some questions.
Yeah, John?
Same that you've been addressing the downside of a consumer society. How long and what would it take for us to become a citizen society where we try to deal with some of these things before it gets to the end?
I'll tell you, I am tremendously optimistic about that, just with my own children, because I will tell you, growing up, I never thought a thing about where my pop cans went, where my newspapers went, anything. I mean, even in college, it wasn't until I was in college that I even started to think about that. My kids will go to a park and will pick up pop cans that they find laying on the ground to make sure they get in the recycling bin. There is a major push now that I hear from young people and from students to not have all this packaging. We don't need all the packaging for many of the consumer products we buy. And so I think that, I really think that it's hard to change the habits of people, but that when consumers begin to demand changes, as the younger generation are demanding changes, that we will see very quickly businesses responding. I was in Disney World this summer with my family, and every place you went there was recycling, and every brochure said this is printed on recycled paper. So I think we are seeing it.
Other questions, comments? Yeah.
How is the EPA handling the roadside dumping, or if you have a vacant lot, someone comes in and dumps hazardous waste midnight, the waste disposal?
Believe it or not, EPA can't handle that one very well because they just aren't aware of it happening as much as your local officials are. I get more calls from county health departments on dumping, especially in rural areas, where a farmer has called the health department and said, look, once again, you know, I've got a fence up, I've got signs that say no dumping. So for now, it's really not being handled. As to those people who truly are criminals, who go about doing that on a regular basis rather than those people who just want someplace cheap to get rid of their old appliances, EPA and the Department of Justice and the U.S. Attorney General's Office have tremendously beefed up criminal enforcement. And I don't have the statistics with me here today, but they are very proud of the number of convictions that they are getting for criminal law violations of environmental statutes. You know, that's one of the real problems that we face all the time. Believe it or not, the landowner is liable for those cleanup costs, and that's just one of the real unfair things, unless you can prove who dumped it there for you. Some county health departments have some minimal amount of money in their budget to assist the local farmer, and some farmers get orders to clean up things and are not very happy about it, do it, and have the same sorts of trash be dumped on their property just weeks later. Dogs are the best defense, I think, on that. Yes, sir.
One thing you might want to address is also some of the landfill areas have filled in wetlands, and owners are being required to restore those back. You might want to avoid that.
Yeah. I sometimes wonder, although I'm sure people in the year, you know, 2025 will wonder what we were thinking of in 1992 as well, but I sometimes wonder what people were thinking of when they located landfills in Indiana in the 30s and 40s. I have three major landfill cleanups right now. One is literally on the banks of a major river, literally on the banks, and so every flood there's erosion from the bank and another drum gets uncovered. The other two are both in floodplains, and one of them in the floodplain we know is filled in wetlands area. And so part of the cleanup project that EPA has demanded is a 2-for-1 mitigation to return wetlands to Indiana. So even though these wetlands were filled in 30 and 40 years ago before our wetlands enforcement was very effective, they are now requesting that we come up with 87 acres of wetlands at another location in Indiana and agree to take care of those wetlands and maintain them as wetlands in perpetuity. It's a real problem.
Yeah.
Is there a limit to the number of cross claims that can be made by a defendant in a case?
No, there's no limit except for the judge's patience, and I will tell you that sometimes is a very powerful limit. I recently had a Superfund case in which there were 400 defendants, and it had been dragging on for years, and the judge finally called us all to his courthouse on the Saturday of the Notre Dame-Purdue football game, and he locked us in and told us we were going to settle the case, and you know what? We settled before the kickoff. It was amazing.
Other questions or comments? Yeah.
What's your interpretation of the Superfund law? Was Congress trying to make industry pay, and they just didn't see that municipalities would get dragged in, and so they missed the boat? Or was it just a subtle way of getting municipalities involved?
No, I really think Congress intended just for industry to pay, and I think they just didn't even conceive of the fact that somebody would go after a municipality. And they specifically thought of instances because the city of St. Louis brought it to them that they were getting contaminated properties delivered to them as owner-operator. And so they said, oh, yeah, well, we can clearly make sure that the city's not an owner where somebody deeds over the property. They never even thought about the fact, I think, that a municipality could become a potentially responsible party just by picking up the city trash. I just don't think they thought that one through.
So industry's going to win.
Yeah, I think eventually, every time the Superfund statute has been reopened and industry tries to get some changes, they end up getting hurt more than they got helped. But I think on this one that they will win.
Other questions? Jackie, thank you very much.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Friday, same time, same place. Jim Ridenour. Hope to see you.